One, two, three.
You can't. Just because I clapped? Was that all it took to get your attention?
It's not what it takes when you're trying to chase a squirrel down.
Hello, lovely people of the internet, and welcome to episode 8 of the Novelty Knitting Podcast. I am your host, Emma, here to talk to you about all things knitting, crafty, basically anything cozy that takes my fancy. Before we get started today, I have two announcements for you guys. The first one, very keen-eared listeners to the podcast will have noticed that I did not say knitting and bookish content, I said knitting and crafty content. I am still going to be doing bookish content, but I will no longer be doing the bookish content in these main podcast videos. I have decided, instead, that I will be doing vlogs for you guys. The vlog format is just going to allow me to be a little bit more succinct in what I'm saying, and it will allow me to react immediately when I finish a book, and those vlogs will also have a little bit of my day-to-day life stuff. You guys can look forward to those going up on the alternate Friday of the podcast. So this podcast will go up, and a week later, the vlogs will go up. The other announcement that I have for you guys is very exciting. So this month is my birth month. I will be turning 27 at the end of June. So I decided that partially because of that, and partially just as a huge thank you to all my subscribers who have helped this channel grow so much more quickly than I ever expected, I'm going to do a little giveaway. Now, before I show you guys what I'm going to be giving away, I do want to just say that I am not super familiar with how international shipping works. I am going to try to make this a worldwide contest, but if you are in a country outside of the US or Canada, I would caution that you might end up having to pay import tax or something like that. Again, I'm super unfamiliar with international shipping, so just keep that in mind if you do live outside of the US or Canada, that there might be a few complications. I will do my absolute best, but please bear with me if the winner is from out of the US. But I guess I should tell you guys how you're going to enter. In order to enter, you just need to leave a comment on this video. It doesn't have to be anything fancy, you don't even have to talk about what happens in this episode, just tell me one thing about yourself. It doesn't have to be craft related, it could be absolutely anything. Tell me about your dog, tell me about your cat, tell me about the vacation you're planning. I do not care, I just really want to get to know you guys. So without further ado, let me show you guys what I am giving away. It is two skeins of Madeline Tosh in their sport weight. Their sport weight is 100% merino, and the colorways are, this one is Phantasm, and then this one is Marfa. Don't love that name. I don't know if it maybe means something that I just don't know, but that is what this one is called. It is kind of an odd name for what I think is a really beautiful colorway. The colors are coming off a little bit brighter than what they are in real life. These are actually fairly muted purpley red tones and some gorgeous dark speckling. I will have what I hope will be a more accurate photo up on my Instagram, which is Emilou Knits, EMMILOUKNITS, which I will have linked in the description down below, so you can check that out. I will be letting people know about the giveaway over on Instagram as well, but you can only enter by commenting on this YouTube video. You can also have a look here at that, this Phantasm colorway. Again, the colors are getting a little bit washed out almost. They look a little bit lighter than what they are in real life. But I mean, a gorgeous dark purple is a gorgeous dark purple. But again, this is my birthday giveaway, two skeins of Madeline Tosh sport weight yarn. Just leave me a comment down below and it can be absolutely anything within reason. Come on guys, be nice. Don't say mean things to me, please. It's my birthday. But the drawing for that will be in just 2 weeks so that I can tell you guys who the winner is with my next video, so that will be drawn on Friday the 25th. Anyway, Hello, lovelies. This is Emma of the future. I just wanted to pop in here for a bonus announcement, which is to say that I am doing another live stream. This one is going to be with a very special guest. Soxy Nana Alice will be joining me on a live stream. We're just going to be doing a super casual, like a knit night style live stream. Please feel free to come and join us. We will be streaming on Friday the 18th at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, 6 p.m. All the things I deal with. Please come and join us. We will just be there chit-chatting. You can come and join in the chat on the live stream, and we will answer questions, but mostly it's just going to be a really relaxed, really fun evening. If you've never seen any of Alice's videos, I will of course be linking her in the description down below. Go and check her out. But that's all I wanted to come in and say. All of the info for that live stream is going to be in the description down below. And back to the video.
Anyway, grab a cup of tea. Again, I have iced tea because it is 86 degrees outside and humidity is oppressive. Actually, let me tell you guys what kind of tea this is. I'm drinking a rooibos tea from IKEA, surprisingly. I did not know they did tea, and honestly, guys, their tea is pretty dang good. I love a rooibos tea. This one has rose hips in it. I wasn't super sure how it was gonna taste iced, but it's really good. I think that I prefer it hot, but both ways are good. Again, anyway, grab whatever you like to drink and let's get started. Okay, I've got what is probably going to be a huge shock to you guys, but it is a finished object, and it is a finished object that I finished in the last 2 weeks. So you guys have never seen this before. It's a summer crop top. Granted, this is quite a small project and it's crochet, so it knits up. This is a very small project and it crochets up really fast, but I am still incredibly proud of myself for casting this on and getting it done in just a few days, actually. I, of course, used this Queensland collection Pima Fresca in their color 17, which is just like this muted pink color. I used most of one skein and then I had to cut the yarn so I could start on the next cup. I decided that I didn't think that this one was going to be quite enough to finish this whole section plus the strap, so I grabbed another skein and I just used a small chunk of that. So you can see a little bit of variation between the two sides. This side is clearly a lighter color than the right side, but I kind of like it. I think it's kind of quirky. It's really cute, and this is just something that I'm going to throw on when I'm doing yard work, when it's a really hot day and I'm just hanging out around the house, because I mean it is a crochet top, so when I put it on you can see a little bit through it and it frankly just shows off just a little bit more of my boobs than I'm comfortable showing in public. That being said, at some point I might take one of my lighter summer tank tops or something and I could possibly layer that over this, and I think that would be really cute. So what happened with this is that basically I had a flash of inspiration about a week ago where I realized that I was thinking that I wanted to knit a top out of these cottons, and then I realized that I can crochet. And I've actually gotten quite good at crochet, and I know from one of the members in my knitting club who also crochets, she has crocheted some of the most gorgeous tops. So I did a quick search for some crochet tops. This one is the summer crop top, and it is a free pattern. So I just went to the blog where this was posted, and I cast it on that very day, and I finished it within 3 days. I probably could have finished it earlier, but the crochet with the cotton is a new experience for me. It hurt my hands a little bit when I was working on this, and this band just ended up taking a lot more out of me than I expected. This top was actually kind of a test, because
I do know how to crochet, but again, I am not super familiar with it, so I wanted to see how well I could read a crochet pattern and how difficult it would be for me. And I wanted to do that with a free pattern before I went ahead and purchased any patterns and tried to do those. So what I think I'm going to do with the rest of this, or at least a good chunk of the rest of this cotton, is knit the Summertime Tee. Summertime Tee is a paid pattern, and it is a bit more expensive than what I'm used to using, but seriously, that thing is so cute, and I think I'm going to absolutely love it. It's very light and very drapey. It hangs off the shoulder, which is a look that I absolutely love. So I will probably cast that on sooner rather than later. I'll probably be prioritizing it because I want to get as much use out of it as I can while it is atrociously hot here in Michigan. Seriously, guys, the humidity is oppressive. I do not know what we would do without air conditioning. I just have to step outside every once in a while to take the dogs out. I try and go for a run in the mornings, and it is horrible. We've had rain for the last couple of days, and it has done absolutely nothing to alleviate the humidity. It's supposed to rain again today, and hopefully that will help. Anyway, I've devolved into talking about the weather. I'm not done talking about this summer crop top. This top is actually a real step forward for me, a real show of body positivity. Now, as you can tell from the video, I am quite skinny, but ever since about when I hit puberty, when I got that little, like, pouch that most women get when they hit puberty for their, you know, organs. And since I don't work out extensively and I don't have a super, super flat stomach, I've been, frankly, self-conscious about my stomach. So even though I only plan to wear this around the house and in the yard, it is still a lot of progress for me, which I am very, very proud of. I just want to be clear that anyone can struggle with body positivity. It doesn't just apply to women, but also men. It can apply to people that you might think have what is considered a socially acceptable or socially attractive body. Anyone and everyone can struggle with body positivity. I hope that no one sees this and thinks, oh my gosh, what does she have to worry about? I am aware that I have skinny girl problems, but that doesn't change the way that I feel in my own body and the way that I look compared to what I am supposed to look like. Now I'm going to go ahead and step down off of my soapbox and move on to my next finished object, which is actually not a finished object, but a half object. It is my Holly Jolly socks. So I have, obviously, one finished. That's where the half of this half object comes from. And then I've got about this much done on the second sock. I mean, this one is not that much of a win, considering that I was about here when I showed these to you guys last, so I really had very little to do on this sock before it was finished. But I tell you what, I will take what I can get. If I actually take time and concentrate on getting one of these done, it takes very little time because it's just rounds and rounds and rounds of stockinette. But with all of the other projects that I've got on the needles right now, I actually quite like having these on the needles because it's something really easy, really basic. I don't have to think about it at all. And I can turn to this when other things are proving to be just too much at the moment. Speaking of too much at the moment, let's move on to my works in progress. I'm gonna stay right on this sock train, and here I can finally show you guys what is becoming of my falling snow socks. So the pattern is a little bit difficult to see. Oh, no, maybe not. It's pretty good. It is not necessarily exactly what I wanted, but I am hoping that the stitches will look a little bit more defined once it is blocked, and especially once it's on blockers or on a foot. Stitches like these tend to stand out a little bit more once you're actually able to stretch out the fabric a little bit. Since the last episode, I think I had to tear out and redo this about two or three more times, just the first 10 to 20 rows, but I actually managed to get footage of it this time and take a couple photos. So this first video, I'm sorry that my dog is proving to be the backdrop. I set this orange pillow that you can kind of see beneath her there, and that orange pillow was going to be the background, but then as soon as I laid out that pillow, she jumped right up there like I was just setting it out just for her. But all in all, I think that I have knit the first 10 to 20 rows of this about 7 times. I can't remember if this is the 7th or the 8th iteration of this. Do you ever look down at your knitting and you are just kind of looking at it kind of closely, and then all of a sudden you see somewhere there's an error? And it's not a big one. Absolutely no one is going to notice this. I only noticed it because I was just now looking very closely at my socks. But right here, I missed a stitch. There's supposed to be a purl stitch, like right in the middle of this void here. Just one. So that's fun. I do have to give a serious shout out about this yarn because it has withstood so well all of that pulling out and re-knitting. Even after pulling out all of those rows 7 or 8 times, I have had absolutely zero trouble with the yarn degrading in any way. It hasn't been more difficult to get my needles in the yarn. It hasn't been snagging between stitches. I've really loved working with this yarn, and I'm very, very impressed with it. So another work in progress that I did not have previously is this sock head hat, which I am knitting out of Malabrigo. I think I showed you guys this yarn previously that I had wound it up, and I had was planning to knit another sock head hat out of it. So that sock head hat has been cast on. I did switch to size 4s instead of size 5s. Funny story about that, actually. I figured out why I cast it on a 5 when I'm pretty sure the pattern calls for like a 2. And that is because I grabbed the wrong circular needle out from my stash. So I had this one needle that I was using every time I knit a sock head hat. It was a 16-inch cord with, I think, 4-inch needles on it, and that is what I knit my very first sock head hat on, and so I just always went for that when I knit sock head hats. I did not realize, and this is just what happens when you stash too many needles, I did not realize that I had the exact same brand of needle in the same 16-inch circular in a size 5 as well as the size that I used for the sock head hat. So when I came across that needle, I was just like, oh, yep, that must be it, and I did not look through the rest of them to make sure that I had the right one. That's how I ended up knitting it on a needle size vastly larger than what the pattern calls for, but again, I really loved the drape of the last sock head hat that I made, so I only went down to a 4. I also think that probably I was just a looser knitter when I was knitting on the smaller size, because this really does not feel that different from some of the original hats that I knit. I am knitting this on a 24-inch circular, which is a little bit difficult to get started. I used the long tail cast-on method, and when I cast this on, it took me absolutely forever to knit that very first row. Now I can just zoom right on through. It's really easy. The yarn bunches up just as much as I need. I do have to stop every once in a while to pull the yarn around, but it's really not hard, especially compared to what I was doing when I had to do that first row. Seriously, I would knit 3 stitches and have to manipulate the yarn so that I could get just a little bit of leeway to knit a few more stitches, and then I would have to do it all over again, which is why it took so long. As soon as that hat is finished, I have plans to cast on a couple more. I have wound up this yarn, which is Stonehenge Fibers in their Crazy brand. This just uses up all of the extra ends that they have when they dye yarn, and I love this. The only trouble is that this is a sport weight yarn, not a fingering weight yarn, so I might have to manipulate the pattern just a little bit to get it to do exactly what I want, and I am going to have to ask my husband, which the blue is for my husband, which side he wants me to start at, if he wants me to pull from the middle or pull from the outside, because the outside is like mixed
mixture of brown and blue very quickly into like a blue and a blue. But the inside is a mixture of like green and black. Now, personally, I like the green, so I want to make sure that the green made it into the hack. I'm positive that I will not use this entire skein, so I don't even know if I'm going to get to this center bit. That being said, I know that my husband adores blue, so probably he will want me to start from the outside. Now, mine, on the other hand, I really, really just want this dark red that's on the inside to be part of the hat. And I have not decided yet whether I want this blue to be my brim or this peachy color. Neither one is necessarily to my usual tastes, but that red definitely is, which is why I actually bought this one. I didn't realize that the red wasn't going to be in there until I got into the middle. Of course, as I was saying, the problem with these is that it's a sport weight, so I am going to have to slightly alter the pattern from what I'm used to. I usually just go ahead and cast on 128 stitches. That usually does it for a really good size hat, especially in this single ply yarn, which stretches a lot, and on the size 4 circulars. So I'll have to play with that. But I do have a kind of funny, kind of just cringy story about getting these two yarns. I actually bought it at the store that is on site of the mill. My husband and I were vacationing in a cabin up north. For anyone that is not from Michigan, I don't know if it extends to other states, but anyone who's not from Michigan, up north just means like the upper part of the lower peninsula or the upper peninsula. That's what we say when we're going traveling. Typically, it means you're going to one of the touristy cities up north or you're going camping. Anyway, we were in Gaylord in October because I love to go on vacation in the fall when kids are back to school and so there aren't any crowds anywhere.
You're interrupting.
We have a guest now. So anyway, I like to vacation in the fall because there's less crowds and because of how gorgeous it is in the north of Michigan in early October because the leaves are starting to change color. And most importantly, it is properly chilly. I am a cold weather person. By the time we get to October, I am ready for it to be winter coat weather. I do not like the heat, so we typically go up north so that I can escape whatever last gasps of summer are trying to ruin my chilly weather, and that way we are able to really cozy up around a fire, we're able to go for hikes in the chill weather. It's really my favorite time of year, so it's the perfect time of year to go on a trip. Anyway, again, I keep going on tangents. I went to the Stonehenge Fiber Mill, and it must have been off-season as far as what they expect to see in terms of their store, because first of all, there was no one at the store. I actually had to like wait for someone to come out of another building so that she could open up the store for me. And then while I was in the store, she just kind of stood there and watched me, which was very uncomfortable. I absolutely hate it when people are watching me like that, especially when I'm looking at yarn. There's something about looking at yarn that just makes me feel like anyone who is watching me, judging my color choices, judging my knowledge or lack thereof about the yarn. I'm sure that that is not the case, but I definitely felt like I was bothering her. So I just picked something out really quick, and then we ended up having to go to another building for her to process my payment. So I will not be going there again. Granted, I am very happy with what I ended up with, but that was just such an awkward interaction that I just cringe even thinking about going back. Don't get me wrong, I will absolutely 100% still be buying this crazy yarn and the shepherd's wool, which is their main product. I absolutely love shepherd's wool. Along with everything else in this episode, as usual, I will have that linked in the description down below so you guys can buy some if you want because it is really beautiful yarn. The skeins tend to be larger than your average worsted weight skein, so you get get more out of it, and they're very reasonably priced. So that awkward interaction is definitely not stopping me from buying their primary products.
Okay, moving on to my Banff cardigan. I did receive a comment, by the way, that told me that I am pronouncing it just fine, so thank you very much for letting me know that I feel much better now. But this Banff cardigan, do you guys remember how last episode I said that I had finished the back, and so I was hoping that finishing that back piece was going to give me the motivation that I needed to finish the front panels very quickly?
Right. Yeah. I think I jinxed myself because I have not knit a single stitch on this cardigan since I talked to you last. I still want it very much. I still have every intention of finishing it. I just haven't picked it up yet.
In fairness to me, I was very distracted working with the Pima cotton, which is very useful at present. This is a top that I am going to be able to wear imminently. Basically, as soon as it stops raining and I end up having to water the plants or go weed the garden or anything like that, I will be using that top. Whereas this one, I probably won't have to use for another couple of months. Thank you so much to Michigan summers.
Then, as far as my patchwork pullover slash festival cardigan goes, I have gone almost no progress. I got, I think, maybe a few more rows that I didn't have last time. I actually worked on this right after I uploaded that episode. Once again, this is not a priority right now because this is going to be very chunky, very woolly, very warm. So I'm very excited to have it, but it is not immediately important to finish this. And quite frankly, again, my focus was on doing this bralette, and I think it was really good for me to have a project that I was able to bang out so quickly, because having these big sweaters that I'm working on is just a little bit discouraging because it feels like it takes forever. And I know, it doesn't help that I cast on about a dozen projects all at once, but shush you. Shush. So this is where I would usually switch into bookish content, but once again, those will be in vlogs now rather than on these podcast episodes. My very first vlog will be coming out in 1 week, next Friday, but now that I don't have to balance that bookish content and my knitting content as far as time goes in these episodes, I do have a little bit more crafty content that I wanted to share with you. If anyone has any more clever ideas that I can use for this segment besides miscellaneous crafting, please do share. I would be more than happy to change that title card because that is not very clever. So first up in this segment is going to be cross stitch. I have had this cross stitch stuff now for years, and I have never once made a single project. I want to so badly. I have a pattern. I bought a pattern from a cross stitch store, and it is absolutely gorgeous. It is Christmas, which should surprise no one, and it is so, so cute, and I want this little thing so badly. The only cross stitch that I own right now, my friend Taylor made for me, and it is hanging on a wall, which I 100% intend to make into a collage of various sized cross stitch projects, but in order to do that, I should probably start cross stitching. I don't even think that I have all the right colors in this pack, which I just got from Joann's, to make this. I think I definitely have some of them, but not all of them, so I have to order those. So I am not going to make any promises necessarily, but my goal is going to be that I will have at least one X out on this fabric so that I am at least starting cross-stitching. Because I feel like once I get started, it should be at least relatively easy to keep myself going from there. It's just that very first stitch that is the hardest. And hopefully having a podcast audience to answer to is going to help me stick to that. Now the other miscellaneous crafty thing that I have for you. Seriously, guys, someone help me come up with a better name for this. Anyway, the other thing that I have for you guys is sewing content. And the reason that I am going like this and looking down is because I have to show to you guys
a sewing machine. So this beauty, as you can see by the tape still on it and the cardboard still on it, is a brand new sewing machine. I got this sewing machine in December last year. I got it as a Christmas gift from my parents. They were incredibly generous with this gift, and it is beautiful and amazing, but I am so intimidated by this machine. Now, before, I had a very basic machine. It didn't have any fancy bells and whistles, and it was getting quite old. It had a tendency to bunch up the bobbin thread on the bottom of my piece, and it would do it, and I wouldn't know until I couldn't move my project anymore. So that was really frustrating. And my mom and I have been wanting to get into quilting, and I will talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So we actually did have a day where we hung out together and we worked on jelly roll quilts. And she must have seen how much I was struggling because she whipped through hers way faster than me. And of course, she does have a lot more experience than I do. But part of that was because I kept having to stop and redo strips because my thread kept getting so messed up. So she bought me a new machine. And this one does have a number of bells and whistles. As you can see, it is a digital interface. It has a bunch of different types of stitches that I can use. I don't even know where to start with this machine. And the longer I wait, the more it feels like the first project that I knit on this needs to be special in some way. I just said knit on this machine. The first project that I sew on this machine feels like it needs to be special, but it doesn't. I just need to go ahead and use it for the very first time. The first time I use it, it doesn't have to be fancy. The first time I use it, I don't have to use these fancy, gorgeous, oh my gosh, these look so cool. The first time I use it does not have to be fancy. It can just be using it to hem some pants or something. So this is a promise. I am 100% committing myself to this. I will have sewed something on this machine. I don't know what it's going to be yet, but I will have sewn something on this machine before the next episodes go live. Along those lines, let me show you the quilt top that my mom and I made over a year ago. I should say that I made while my mom was making her own quilt top. So this one is all me, and my mom has a separate one. So these colors and these patterns in here are so gorgeous. They are 100% me. I absolutely adore these fall tones. This is what I would have my entire wardrobe be if I could, which I suppose as a sewist I could in theory, but we are not going to go there right now. So as you can see, this is just a super basic jelly roll quilt. For those that are not initiated in the quilting world, which I mean, I have maybe half an initiation, if we're being honest. A jelly roll is just a bunch of these strips of fabric, and it's enough to make a very reasonably sized quilt, as you can see from this. Now, my problem at this point is that I know how clearly to make a quilt top, but breaking into the quilting world is extremely difficult. The top, again, easy enough, but I have no idea how to go to the next step. I know that I need to get backing fabric and batting, and I need to make a sandwich of those things. And I know that I will have to bind the edges, and I know that I will have to quilt the inside of it so that the sandwich of the batting and the backing fabric and the quilt top come together. I don't really know how. I know how to buy the backing fabric and how to buy the batting. For example, I know that this is wider than what you would get off a typical bolt of fabric, so I will have to get special backing fabric unless I want to get two lengths of the backing fabric, and then I would have to sew those two lengths together in order to make it wide enough, I think. Again, getting into the quilting world is really hard because I don't really know the questions to ask. And when I go into quilting stores, the people there
seemed to lack the ability to remember what it was like when you first start quilting. Most likely, they have been doing it for so long that they themselves don't honestly remember. So when I come in and say, I'm making a quilt, how do? I guess that's probably what they have beginner quilting classes for. But I already know how to sew. I know how to piece things together in theory. I can do, I think, the basics fairly well, but whenever I walk into those stores and I start asking questions, I get confused basically immediately. I only understand about half of what the quilters in those stores are talking about, and then, quite frankly, a lot of times they will get just straight up condescending with me. Again, quilting people just don't seem to understand how difficult it is when it's your very first quilt, which can be, quite frankly, extremely disheartening. It's so hard to walk into a store and know that you know nothing and are trying to figure it out, and then it is so much worse and makes me completely stall out when it comes to working on this project when I enter a store and the people are frankly just disrespectful or condescending. It does not make me want to finish this, but I am going to finish it eventually. I know at the very least that my next step is to even out these edges. I have a cutting mat and I have a rotary blade. I think I need, or at least to make me comfortable with cutting down all of this work that I've already put in, I am going to want to get a clear plastic ruler so that I can lie that on top and know that I'm cutting at least somewhat of a straight line down this thing. And then I have fabric to do a border on this, and then we will be full on in you need to figure out this whole quilting backing thing. So that's not necessarily what I'm going to be doing for my very first thing on my new sewing machine, because again, I'm still trying to figure things out, but it is definitely up there on the list of things that I want to get done and figured out very soon. But that is everything for this episode, guys. Thank you so much for joining me. Again, as a reminder, I've got that giveaway going on. It's only going to last these 2 weeks, so if you leave a comment in the comments below on this video, you will be automatically entered to win that giveaway. Otherwise, please like and subscribe, and I will see you guys in my vlog next week. If you're not here for the vlogs, I will see you in podcast episode 9 in 2 weeks.